great disturbance in the Force.
I can feel your anger.
Stretch your feelings.
Stretch out with your feelings.
Reach out with your feelings.
Use your aggressive feeling.
Feel. Don't think.
Reach out.
I did feel something.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.
Hello, and welcome to Feeling the Force. I am your host, Sarah.
And I am your other host, Alex. And welcome to our very first bonus episode.
Yay!
Happy holidays, everyone. This is a New Year's release.
Yes, to celebrate the new year, we are doing a little bit of a bonus episode. We teased in our last regular episode that for Life Day, we watched the holiday special. And we thought, well, why not podcast about it?
Indeed, but before we do that, as this is a bonus episode, my personal feelings are going to come out about a little bit of Star Wars before we get started. Some people may be aware, and some may not, of Adam Driver has recently done an interview in promotion of one of his new movies, and in so doing stated that Kylo Ren's original arc was supposed to be he was the bad guy. All the way through. And it was supposed to be he was the opposite of Anakin. And they say where he would start unsure about the dark side and end completely involved in the dark side, where Anakin started completely good and then turned completely unsure and was eventually turned. And so this makes me mad because it was set up completely well in Force Awakens and Last Jedi, and then they fumbled the bag with Rise of Skywalker.
I mean, I think that's just the summary of the Rise of Skywalker, which I am appreciative to know a little bit about the creative process for the sequel trilogy, because they've been quiet about it, in part because I think there was no plan, which is frustrating.
I don't think so. I think there was a plan and they changed it.
Right. And some of it they had to because of the passing of Carrie Fisher, which, you know, you can't predict going into this. But a lot of it, I think, is reactive to the trolls from The Last Jedi and wanting to try to please everyone. They just kind of brought it all back.
Right. And the reason I bring this up is not to like just go on about that, but I brought this up because there are a lot of people apparently out there that wanted him to be redeemed. And that is why he was redeemed. Mm-hmm. And that is why they changed that, is because they wanted him to be redeemed. But then a lot of them got angry at how they did it, and they didn't do it right. And I'm just like, well, if you go by Adam Driver, which I will trust him over many of the Star Wars collectives at the moment because they're all trying to cover their butts, and he just doesn't really care anymore, which I appreciate, and he is going to tell the truth. And yeah, there was a plan for him to be completely dark and be the big bad in Rise of Skywalker, and they changed it, and they made him the good guy. And it's just that's why I bring this up. It's not because it's just frustrating that they changed it. And I thought Last Jedi perfectly set it up for being him being the big bad, where he was tempted to come back from Rey and eventually did. But anyway, I digress.
That's what we do in a bonus episode. We digress. We show our true colors a little bit more. And we also get feisty about the holiday special.
Oh, yeah, this is going to be an interesting episode. I don't know if this is going to be... This is not going to be like our normal episodes where we are going through and identifying characters and doing three parts, because I don't even know if this is going to be a super long episode. But we're also going to be diving into just some random things and go on tangents and discussions. So if that's not for you, that's fine. This is why it's a bonus episode. If you want to come back for the regular emotions, that will be in our next release that will come out later this month about our original trilogy wrap-up.
Yeah, but if you're ready to join us on this adventure, buckle up.
I had a really good feeling about this.
All right, so we every year watch the Star Wars Holiday Special because it is amazing, and... If you didn't hear, Sarah just giggled her head off. And I love it. I discovered it in college, which is a good, oh my gosh, almost over a decade ago. And I have watched it every year since then. Did I introduce you to it, or had you seen it before?
I had seen it before. So I had found it on YouTube back when I was in junior high and first getting into Star Wars, and I absolutely hated it. And when Alex told me when we first started dating that he watches it every year, I was like, what? But it's a combination of things. One, Alex watches it for it's so bad, it's hilarious type mentality, which I can appreciate. And I'm also in a different place in my fandom because when I was first starting out, I took everything super seriously. And so then the holiday special sat really weirdly with me because I'm like, this doesn't make sense. How is this canon? Is this not canon? I was very concerned about that first starting out. And now I'm a lot like, I want to have fun with Star Wars. And I take the holiday special as having fun with Star Wars now.
It is so fun.
Yeah. So Alex did not introduce me to it, but he bribed me into giving it a second chance.
I did. And she now watches it with me every year. So I think it was a good bribe.
Yes, I do so willingly now.
So we also actually watched a documentary this year called A Disturbance in the Force that actually goes into how the Star Wars Holiday Special was made, which I highly recommend. It kind of goes through all the details of how it was made. Again, it doesn't put our Lord and Savior George Lucas in the best light. And I enjoy that because I don't think he's perfect and everyone thinks he's perfect. And in the movie, in the documentary, it tells you of like he was a part of the holiday special. Everyone thinks that he wasn't, but he was. And he has just been able to manage, he has managed to disassociate his name from something that just bombed.
Yeah, it was a really interesting to see how it all came together, the different thought processes behind it, kind of why and how it came to be. And I personally enjoyed because they gave some other clips and other examples of how Star Wars was brought into kind of the mainstream media at that time. Like, I knew that Mark Hamill had guest starred on The Muppet Show, and they had kind of did a whole thing with Star Wars and that because I'm a Muppet fan.
That was after Empire Strikes Back, though.
Well, yes, but it's kind of along those same lines of how they showed clips of, like, the Star Wars characters going on the Donnie and Marie show.
That was also a thing, though, because, yeah, it's a lot worse. That's a lot worse. And so, again, I think I like the documentary because it basically tells you like the holiday special was made and was never meant to be seen again. It was a variety show, and variety shows in the 70s were made as junk television to put on, have people watch it and forget it. It was not designed, and so they didn't know what they had with Star Wars of. There is a lore with Star Wars. There is a people want to hold on to these characters versus just, hey, look, it's a variety show from a TV show, blah, 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 blah.
Right. And so the documentary gets into a little bit of how you bring in all those variety show pieces, which, again, are kind of a one-off. You're not going to – I mean, at the time, you couldn't record it. You know, the VCR technology wasn't there to record it at home. But then you also have, like, attempts at canon of, like – introducing the Wookiee home planet and all of these customs and rituals around it. And it is an interesting juxtaposition.
Well, the whole thing, this is the thing. I don't think mentioned it in the Star Wars, in the documentary, but I've looked this up of like the whole reason they are on Kashyyyk is because George Lucas chose this. Like George Lucas wrote the story and then it was altered and changed and stuff like that. But like he chose like Chewbacca's family. Mm-hmm. And literally the hardest part of this movie, of the show, is that it is Chewbacca's family. And we can't hear, there's no audible dialogue for 9 minutes. It's all just Wookiee shriek.
Right. And so, yeah, that's a challenge for the audience. That's a challenge for the directors. You know, you're basically pantomiming for the first 10 minutes of the special.
Yeah. So, highly recommend it. Disturbance in the Force. Check it out. It's pretty good. I think it's on Apple Plus or Apple TV or whatever that's called. And so ready to dive in with our emotions in the Star Wars holiday special?
Yeah, so kind of running through from the top of the movie, we'll give a little bit of a plot summary here for folks who have never seen it, or it has been a hot minute since you've last seen it. So the overarching plot is Chewbacca wants to get home to his family on Kashyyyk to celebrate the Wookiee holiday of Life Day. This is a day where they gather together with their family and give thanks, and there is something about the tree, I don't fully remember, but it's like the tree where they all come from. It is like the tree of life type thing. But he needs to get back. And the Imperials want to capture Chewbacca because he's a rebel and is traveling with Han. And they're on the lookout in Kashyyyk's system for rebel activity. So it is a bit of dodging and trying to get Chewbacca in home safely. And kind of where the variety show piece comes in is you have the family at home waiting and they're trying to bide the time before Chewbacca gets there. So that's where some of the variety pieces come in. You have some diversions and distracting of the Imperial officers that come to raid the house that also get brought into the variety piece. And then you get brief appearances by Princess Leia and Luke Skywalker. Am I missing anything, Alex?
Introduction of Boba Fett.
Yes. So we get introduced to Boba Fett in the holiday special, for those who didn't know. Lumpy, which is Chewbacca's son, watches like a, it's like a rebel propaganda cartoon. Yep. He watches like a rebel propaganda cartoon. And in that, Chewie, Han, and Luke are getting this medallion and they need the help of one Boba Fett and learn that he's working for the Empire.
We're going to talk about this now. Sarah thinks the Mark Hamill cartoon is hotter than the Harrison Ford cartoon, and I'm wondering how much Mark had to pay for Sarah to say that.
Mark didn't have to pay me anything.
Then you're wrong, because Mark Hamill is never more attractive. I'm sorry to say, never more attractive than Harrison Ford, even now.
But that's what I'm saying, like, the physical persons, yes. Harrison Ford is hotter than Mark Hamill, but the cartoon, they make Mark Hamill hotter. So I want to know how much Mark paid the animation company to make him hotter than Harrison. Yeah, so I mean, Mark, if you want to pay me to say nice things, sure, you can become a sponsor of the podcast. That would be great. But no, if you paid off the animation company to make your caricatured self look harder than Harrison Ford's caricatured self.
That is true. Harrison's face kind of looks pretty long in the animation.
Yeah, it is caricaturish long, and like his eyes are never open, and it's kind of weird.
He is asleep for most of it, though.
That is true, yes. That is part of the plot, which we don't need to get into. But Boba Fett is pretty cool, and people get excited about Boba Fett. And then, as we learned in the documentary, then he comes in at the Empire Strikes Back, and it's all very exciting. But at the end of it all, Chewbacca safely makes it home. We celebrate Life Day with all of the other Wookiees. All of the other Rebel friends are there. Luke and Leia are able to make it back. And Carrie Fisher sings us a lovely song to celebrate Life Day.
And she would only do the special if she was allowed to sing.
True statement. It's a fine song. Like, not bad, but not memorable.
If you ever wanted words for classic John Williams songs, this is the place to find it.
Yep, they just took a lot of the songs or the music from the score in the first movie and just put words to it. And Leia's song is not the only one that does that. There's a song sung in a cantina to the song, to the cantina band song, just slowed down a bunch.
Indeed.
Okay, so that's a sufficient summary. If you need more, how about you go watch it?
I recommend it to everyone. It's amazing.
Okay, but starting back at the beginning, we open up the movie with Chewbacca's wife and child and an elderly Wookiee all waiting for his arrival.
It's his dad.
Well, I didn't know if it was his dad or Mala's dad.
Oh, no, it is Chewie's dad.
Okay, Chewie's dad.
I didn't know you didn't know that.
I didn't want to make assumptions.
No, it is canon that he's Itchy is Chewie's dad.
Okay, but that's where we start. And I get something pretty early on there of Itchy yelling at Lumpy because Lumpy's playing with his starships and running around the living room and kind of gets up in Itchy's hair while he's playing. So I counted that as anger of like, hey, knock it off. get out of my space.
I did not register that. I thought it was more of just telling him what to do. And I struggled with the Wookiees because their yelling and growling doesn't really change in pitch and is kind of loud. So I thought it was just like talking of like, hey, go do your chores versus that. So, but thinking about it, like Lumpy is annoying him.
Sure. And I mean, we've talked about the difficulties with Chewbacca and Treewook in our regular episodes. So I'm not surprised we might have a little bit of difference or difficulty here. I next have Mala being angry with Lumpy for like watching the acrobats. Our first variety show detour, there's like a troop of acrobats that Lumpy watches as a hologram. And I think Mala's annoyed with that because he's supposed to be helping her like prepare the meal or doing the chores. And like I get that she's more angry than say just like Itchy was because she bares her teeth and gets huffy with him and has some more of that body language of like hands on the hips with it.
I did not get that. You saw it. I didn't.
Okay, that sounds great. What do you have next?
Mine. I don't have anything. I don't have much for this episode. I have an Imperial officer gets angry at Mala and tells her that he can't control it. His men when they get angry.
Oh yes, I see that. I have quite a few before that.
Okay.
So sorry about that. I have one when we go to the trading post and there's that Imperial officer purchasing something. The sales clerk tries to sell him like this little portable fish tank and he says, I hate fish.
Oh, that was a good catch. Cause that, I don't know why I didn't write that one down, but I do have him, the Imperial, angry and being like, I'll take it. I said, I'll take it. And getting angry. I do have that one, but I did not write down that I hate fish. That's a good catch.
Thank you. Yeah, the whole time the Imperial is in that shop, he is just very agitated and short-tempered.
Well, he's trying to show everyone that who hasn't seen this, because this is, again, not just for Star Wars fans, that this is an Imperial and he's a bad person. So what better way to do that than through anger?
True. The next bit I have is a cutscene that we get to of Han and Chewie trying to fly through space and make their way to Kashyyyk. I just have the note Han mildly annoyed by Imperials. So,
and I think this goes to like how half-hearted Harrison Ford was in doing this. I did not get any anger out of it. I was just like, yeah, I know, I'm sorry, let's go. I'm trying to get you there. So I didn't get it.
Yeah, no, and that is fine. And then we get to the point in the holiday special where the Imperials raid the homestead. I know Alex had mentioned with an officer, but before that, I get Lumpy biting the Imperial officer. And I took that as anger.
I don't think he bite him? I thought he just like snarled at him and like kind of made the biting chomp.
That's what I mean by that.
Okay, so I don't think he actually bit him. Because if he actually bit him, I think Lumpy would not be alive.
True. I also then have that Mala is angry that the Imperials are in her home.
I read that as fear.
And I could very much see that.
Yeah, most of the stuff I see with Mala when the Imperials are in the house are she's afraid for Lumpy and herself and Itchy as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's a little bit of our iceberg there. But then you made mention of the trooper having a quote about his men getting angry.
Yeah, because he's like, you need to control your son. And he's like, you need to control him because if you don't control him, he'll make my men angry. And I can't control my men when they're angry.
Yeah, that's a pretty interesting statement.
Yeah, it's pretty evil.
Yeah, it's very threatening and ominous and just be like, yep, they're going to do horrible things and we have no checks and we ain't even going to try.
Well, it's like he's trying to basically handle this situation or we're going to my men are going to perform atrocities on this house. Like, that's literally what he's saying, because he's just like, I can't control them. Oh, and he says it in like that, like, I can't control my men when they're angry. And I'm just like, okay, we're very cavalier about this.
Yeah, the Imperials are portrayed very, like, ruthlessly evil in this special.
And I think it's like, comically ruthlessly. So I think a lot of it has to do with probably the variety show aspect of it, of they don't know what the Imperials are and stuff like that. And so they don't realize that when they say, like, I can't control them when they're angry, like, they're not realizing that they exterminate people and stuff like that. Like, so I think it's the writers not knowing what's going on.
Oh, for sure. I think that is part of that. And I mean, like, any kind of variety type show, you ham it up, and so that I think gets hammed up with it.
Yeah, agreed.
So I jump next to the cartoon.
I agree.
So in the cartoon, we mentioned that Lumpy watches a rebel propaganda cartoon. In that, we have Chewbacca and we meet Boba Fett. I have Chewie angry at Boba Fett for not letting him go with him into the town to get the serum that Luke and Han need.
I don't have that one, but I have one before that. Mm-hmm. I have Boba Fett angry at the beast, at his beast that he's riding, and he hits it because he's angry because it's eating. It's eating his things, and then he gets angry at Luke for feeding it, saying, you're wasting your time on this beast.
Yeah, he's really mean to this animal that he's riding because he calls it stupid multiple times.
Yeah, and there's anger out of, like, yeah, he hits it, and he's just like, you're wasting your resources on this.
Yeah, that was, I guess, trying to establish himself as a tough guy, but it comes across mean.
Yep.
Do you have anything else in the cartoon itself?
No, I do not.
Okay, because I have right after the cartoon, the head Imperial officer that's in the house gets mad that Lumpy is, like, reacting to the cartoon and, you know, says aloud, what's going on now?
Did not catch that.
Okay.
I do have a question about mean versus angry.
Okay, what's your question?
The Imperial is a real jerk to Lumpy after they destroyed his room. Like, he literally goes up to Mala and goes, he'll have some... And I'm like, I don't know. Is that just him being happy and mean? Like, getting joy out of being mean? He's like, he'll have something to do now. I'm like, is that him, like, just being happy? Because he didn't actually laugh. But, like, I'm just... I don't know. That's where I was tough of, like, that seems really mean. And, like, why be so mean? And... to me, it just comes off of, like, a little bit of anger, but I could be wrong.
I didn't get any anger in that, but I think this kind of circles back to our previous point of the people who were involved in the show didn't necessarily know who the Imperials were, and you're also going to kind of ham up everything. So it's like, I'm just going to destroy, you know, tear your room apart, destroy your room because I can, and I'm going to get joy out of it because I'm the bad guy.
Okay. I guess that, yep. I guess that works. All right, then we get our view into Tatooine life.
Yeah, it's really weird. The Imperial Broadcast Network, like, takes a live feed from a cantina in Tatooine, and it's like...
not just any cantina. It's the exact cantina we saw in A New Hope.
Yes, and it's like it's supposed to, like, make the other people... in the Empire feel good about themselves. It's really weird.
Yeah, so I got a lot of anger in this scene.
Me too. Because it starts out with everyone in the cantina having a good time. And then a alert comes on at the cantina saying that an Imperial curfew has been instated. And everyone gets mad at that.
See, I don't think they did. I didn't get that. I got that there were steps to that. So I got that they were mad that the Bith Cantina band was angry first at the curfew and having to go home. Specifically the Bith Cantina band, and then I have that the bar customers got angry at Arthur, not the Imperials. Mm-hmm. That's where I was, because they were like, they just didn't pay attention to the announcement, and Bay Arthur's character is trying to tell them all to go home, and they're ignoring her and demanding drinks.
They even throw stuff at her.
Yeah, and like they're clamming things down. Yep, and then I have Arthur returns that because she's Bay Arthur returns that anger because she gets mad at people for coming into the bar and not leaving.
Yeah, she starts yelling.
She starts yelling and like has to go like starts trying to yell and tell people to go away, and then has to get her like security guard involved and has to tell him to back off. And then she gives in and lets them all have another drink and goes into a nice song.
Yeah. But that's the last bit of anger that I have in the whole movie, is just kind of that whole anger of around closing and the patrons don't want to leave, and B wants everyone to leave to comply with the curfew.
I have two more instances of anger. First anger is Sarah was very angry to see the rat in the cantina bar scene. She was very upset seeing the rat because she did not notice it apparently at any point previous times we've watched it. And then we saw it in the Disturbance of the Force, and you're like, oh my gosh, there's a rat. This is terrible. And I'm like, it's always been there. And you're like, no, it hasn't. And then we saw it, and she got mad.
Yes. Thank you, Alec. To provide some context for our listeners, I do not like rats. I do not like mice. They are fine outside, should be other places. They just kind of give me the heebie-jeebies. And so there's all manner of characters in the cantina, a lot of costume recycling from the previous cantina scene in A New Hope. But then they just pull out like this giant rat, like legit rat, like not like rat-like creature. It's just a giant human-sized rat that B. Arthur sings to for 5 seconds.
Yeah, it's even bigger than the rodents of extraordinary size from Princess Bride. Yeah, it's huge. It's just a life-size rat.
Yeah, and he's just chilling out in like this corner booth at the cantina, and B sings to him. I'm just like, this is a health code violation. You should not serve his kind here. This is a problem.
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you for bringing the real world into our analysis here. I'm just disturbed at that.
Then I will say my last instance of anger, and this one was hard, so I can understand you not catching it, but I have the stormtroopers angry at Lumpy for causing the signal to send everybody back to base. And because he runs up the stairs to get to Lumpy, then tries to chase and grab Lumpy, and then chases him outside, and so I just got an anger where he's like, I'm trying to like, oh, like how dare you do this, like, and I, it's all through body signals and stuff like that, so it's, there's no way to really know, but that's the vibe I got off of him, was that he was angry or frustrated that this little Wookiee was causing all this problems.
No, I think that's a good catch, because it is kind of weird, because most of the Imperials, they hear that signal and they're like, oh, I guess we got to go back to base, and they just go back. And so like, he is that specific officer or that specific trooper is like the only one realizing like we've been tricked, or like trying to go after Lumpy.
Well, he's the only one that sticks around, because everybody else, he sends everybody away, or they send everybody away, and then they're like, oh, we're supposed to go back to base, we'll leave this one guy here. And then it's like the return to base, return. And then he goes and investigates. So, yeah.
Yeah. So I think that that is a good catch.
So other than that, yeah, the rest is all happy. We get all the return of everybody. And we get magic transportation of all of our main characters somehow end up in the Tree of Life. Together, even though it was a big hoopla about how do we get Chewie there. And then we have the cult scene where they're all walking into an orb and
wearing matching
all red robes, and yeah, so, and that's our movie.
It's fun. It is a bit of a wild ride, but it's fun.
It is. It's such a wild ride. It's so good, you guys. Everybody should go out and look for it. They really need to release it.
Yeah, it'll be interesting because, well, they even mentioned that in the documentary, because the documentary has been made in the past couple of years. So since Disney,
literally this year. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Since Disney has acquired Lucasfilm. And so there was, you know, kind of some mumblings in the documentary of like of speculation of like, is Disney, you know, it'd be a way for Disney to, you know, they could really sit on the platform and try to monetize and monopolize on it.
I mean, it's slowly becoming more knowledgeable. Like as in the documentary, they talk about how Jon Favreau is trying to make it canon with the Mandalorian's weapon, and like the faithful Wookiee, the animation that is literally in the special is on Disney Plus.
Yeah, you can just go watch the cartoon on Disney Plus without the rest of the holiday special.
Right. So, like, it's slowly working its way up there. We'll see if it ever comes, but...
Well, at Galaxy's Edge on Bat 2, they actually do a Life Day celebration.
That is not official. They do, no. They are... They do profit off of Life Day, and they do post, like, robes and stuff like that, but there is not, like, an official Life Day event. That is just a communal, everybody gets together on that day and celebrates Life Day.
Okay, so it's something that fans are organizing. But I know that I've seen like official Disney merch of like a plush Chewbacca in a robe, or like you can buy an ornament that looks like the orbs.
Yes, no, absolutely. They are doing that. So it's again, they're profiting off of it. I mean, there's a Life Day book now, and like none of this would be real. There's a Life Day collections of stories. There's Life Day cookbooks. There's all these things that Disney is profiting off of. And so it's slowly trying to work its way into the zeitgeist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So thank you for bonus potting with me, Alex.
Thank you for bonus potting with me, Sarah.
And thank you for listening, listeners. Give us a shout out if you like the bonus content. If you'd rather us just stay in our lane and do movie analysis, we'd love to hear from you. We're active on our Facebook page at Feeling the Force Podcast, and Instagram
is Feeling the Force Pod. And we can also send us an email at feelingtheforcepod@gmail.com.
And check out our website, feelingforcepod.com.
And always remember,
your focus determines your reality.
Your focus determines your reality.